Hi, my name is Brian Holt, and I'm a Senior Program Manager at Microsoft. Welcome to the complete intro to Linux and the command line. I created this course because I believe it's essential for modern developers to learn how to use Linux and the command line. Linux has become the backbone of modern computing, and most developer tools today use the command line. The skills that you learn in this workshop will absolutely help you in your daily work, whether that's in Mac, Windows, or Linux. In this course, you'll learn fundamentals of the command line, how to use Ubuntu, how to quit Vim, package management in Linux, and writing your own shell scripts. I hope you enjoy the course. Let's talk about reverse search. This is another one that, like, when my coworker at Reddit showed me, it actually might have even been Nina when we worked together at Reddit, showed me how to search my bash history quickly. If you hit Control R, it does this reverse I search here, and I start typing. Let's say I wanted to find the last ls command that I ran. I just start typing something, and it's going to start completing based on things in my bash history. So you can see here, I've typed in ls space. That's what I've put in there. And this is the last thing that I ran that matches that. And so if I just hit enter now, it'll run that for my bash history. Like, I use that constantly as well because, like, my bash history is 10 million miles long because I've been running the command line forever. And this will allow me to search back through and find, like, really long, complicated commands that I've run that I don't want to just, you know, hit up to, you know, scroll through until I eventually find. So another thing to know about the reverse search, if I hit Control R again, ls space, and let's say, like, it was another thing that was ls space and wasn't this one, so I want to go further back in the history, you just hit Control R again, and you'll keep going back through your history as long as you keep hitting Control R. Then you can just hit if you just hit, like, right or left on your keyboard, it'll just drop you into the normal terminal with that pasted in. So another one that I just use absolutely constantly. Talk about bash history for a second. So we talked about that things that you type in go into your bash history. That's what up and down is using. That's what the reverse search is using. But just so you know where your bash history is, if I hit tail and then tilde dash bash underscore history, like that, this is going to show me the last things that I ran. That's what tail does. Tail just outputs the last 10 lines from a file. And your bash history will have everything you've ever run. But I just want to let you know where that is. So if you go in and you delete your bash history, it'll delete all of your history. So that's a good thing to do if you've, like, put a password in there or something like that. You can actually just go in and edit it directly and delete the passwords and stuff like that. We'll talk more about tail later, but that's where it is, in case you're wondering. It's in your... In fact, where am I right now? I'm in my home directory. So if I just hit ls-a, you can see one of those is bash history right there. Another thing to keep in mind is your bash history is not written out to on the fly every single time. It actually buffers all of your commands in your current session. And then as soon as I log out, it'll write all that stuff to bash history. So it's not always writing to it. You have to log out for it to write to your bash history. Let's talk about another one. So if I do ls-a, right, or let's do this again, ls-a. Let's say I wanted, for whatever reason, to run it again. You can actually put exclamation point, and it's actually going to do the exact same command that you did last time. You'll often hear people call this bang, bang. I don't know why computer scientists choose to call exclamation points bang, but they do. So for good or for worse, that's what I'm going to call it too. It's probably good for you to get used to hearing it. Now, why is this useful? In this particular case, this isn't useful. I could have typed ls-a, or I could have hit up enter. However, you can actually insert that into another command. So the reason why I use bang bang all the time is, let's say I do something and I needed to do sudo, which I'll talk about sudo in a bit. You can do sudo bang bang, and it'll actually rerun the last command with sudo. And again, we'll talk about sudo in a bit, but that's when I use bang bang. That just works in bash. I don't even think that even works in ZSH. So be aware of that. So if you're on Mac, that might not work.
Everything is all set up now. We need to get an IP address from the secondary so that the primary can connect to the secondary. So if I say ifconfig here, ifconfig, I actually end up using this command a lot. This actually will just show you a bunch of information about the computer's place on the network. So you can see here it prints out a bunch of numbers and broadcasts and net masks and that kind of stuff. I don't know what half of these means. But the one that we're looking for is actually this one, 192.168.6.4.3. So this is my network address on this network that I'm on at the moment. And the network in this particular case is just, it's a fabricated virtual network on my computer that multipass has created. It's not even multipass. I could actually access this from macOS, right? So it's actually the network on my computer. This one down here, you can see this inet here, this 127.0.0.1. That's a special address that's called the loopback. So it's how a computer refers to itself. So you've probably seen like those mugs, like there's no place that like 127.0.0.1. There's no place like that would be like your home, right? So you can even see it says right here, local loopback. So that's how a computer can refer to itself as an address. This one here, you can see that it says Ethernet. This is actually like the real network address. So suffice to say, the one that we're looking for here is 192.168.64.3. Make sense? This one's an interesting as well. The net mask here, 255.255.255, means that these first three numbers are locked in. Like they actually can't change for this particular network. And you can see the broadcast is 192.168.64. That means that's going to be those numbers that are locked in that won't vary for this network. And the .255 here means that this is the number that varies. So if we look at the various different numbers, it's only varying on that last number. And then I think this INET 6 one is the IPv6 of it. I never used those, so I actually really not totally sure. Anyway, here we go. So grab this INET, this 192.168.64. Yours might be different than mine. It might be the same. I'm not sure. But this is the number that you're looking for right here. OK? And now, let's see. What should work now, this was on secondary, so I got the IP off of secondary. I'm going to come back to my primary, and I'm going to say SSH Brian at that number. It's going to ask you, it's like, are you sure? The reason why it does this is if the computer, like the actual physical server, changes underneath you, you'll know. So this key is actually exchanges like, hey, I'm this server. Do you know that you trust this server? And if you say yes, it's going to store that on your computer and say, in the future, it's going to check that every single time to make sure you're connecting to the same server. And if that server changes, it's going to say, hey, something changed. This is not the same computer I was connecting to before. And it won't let you until you resolve that situation. And you can see here, by doing that, I have now SSH. So I have my primary computer that's going over the network and connected to the secondary. And now we have set it up SSH. So again, I can just say exit, and that will drop me back to Ubuntu, and I can reconnect as much as I want. So I'm going to make another file here inside of my bin. And this is going to just be called like check, or we'll just do touch check number. And we'll do a chmod plus x of check number. And then we're going to vi check number. And then we'll do our little hash bang at the top, slash bin slash bash. OK. And then we're going to say if $1, put a space there so it's a little bit more readable, is greater than 10, then echo greater than 10. Else if, that's how you write an else if, is elif, write that. We can write another test in here. $1 is less than 10. Then echo less than 10. And then finally you can do else, echo. Equals 10. And then again, always at the end, fi, like that. Okay, so now I can write quit here, and I can say check number 10. All right, so check number. So if I put 10, it says equals 10. If I put 11, it's greater than 10. And if I put 9, it is less than 10. So that's how you do ifs, else ifs, else, and then you always have to finish with the fi.